Good morning, this is Kim Hammer, pastor of Saline Baptist Church in Tull, outside of Benton, with your morning devotion taken from the book of Leviticus, chapter 10. This chapter is about relationships between man and God, and relationships between each other. And it also shows how strict God was with regards to his laws and how he expected individuals to follow those laws and the consequences of what happened if they didn't follow these laws. One of the things we need to remember is that the structure that was set up was all with the intent of showing man that he is incapable of being able to fulfill the law, which meant that when Christ came on the scene years later and brought grace, that grace was a much easier solution to the problem than the legalistic system that man wanted set up by God so as to be able to have a uniform way to go about worshiping God. When we get into chapter 10, we find that two of Aaron's four sons, by the names of Nadab and Abihu, they did something wrong with regards to the worshiping of the Lord and the handling of the sacrifices, to the point that God removed them. In other words, God took their lives. It says that they took their censers, put fire in them, and added incense, and they offered unauthorized fire before the Lord, contrary to his command. This could probably go back to, and while we don't have the explicit details, it could go back to something that they did in the way of offering the sacrifices in a wrong manner. Could be that they offered sacrifices unto other gods. The nation of Israel was not immune to dealing with other gods within their belief system. And as a result, it could be that they offered sacrifices using the Lord's instruments unto other gods. Part of the reason I believe this is true is because it emphasizes the fact that what was to be done with the instruments and with the temple and the tabernacle and the holy place, those things were to be done holy because God is holy. So anything that they did stepped outside the boundaries of offering unto God in a holy manner. He will not tolerate sin in his place, and he will not tolerate using his holy vessels to do sinful actions with or to worship other gods. And so we find that these individuals, these two boys, that they died because they used unauthorized fire before the Lord. I can't help but believe, I have no reason to read this into the scriptures, just taking it from personal life application, listening to some things that have happened to parents over the years. I just can't help but wonder if Aaron thought, well, where did I go wrong that my boys did this? And the reality is that we are all individuals, and we all have our ability to make our individual choices. And Aaron's boys made their individual choice. They had been raised right. They had been through, just not very long ago, a chapter or two before, they had been through the ceremonial process of being set up as priests to worship unto the Lord and to handle the sacrifices between the people and God, and to handle all the different type offerings. So it wasn't like they were not educated in the right thing to do. They just chose to do the wrong thing, and there's the difference. They were educated in the right thing to do, but they chose to do the wrong thing. And as a result, their choices had consequences and actions to the most severe level that it cost them their life. Aaron, in all probability, didn't do anything wrong, but the boys just made choices. They were adults. They can make up their own mind, but it also meant they were accountable for their actions, and as a result of it, it cost them their life. God had forewarned them that something like this would happen. Moses brought that to their attention, brought that to Aaron's attention in chapter 3, and he said, "Among those who approach me, I will show myself holy." That's why I said a while ago, I think that whatever they did that was inappropriate or unauthorized, as the scripture says, it was outside the framework of what God said his sanctuary was to be used for and the methodology of approaching him. So he said, "Among those who approach me, I'll show myself holy." Whatever they did in his sight, it was not holy. It was disrespectful to the God, to the point that God took their life. And he said, "In the sight of the people, I will be honored." Don't you know that when these two boys were killed because they authorized unholy sacrifices before the Lord, that the message went out to the rest of the people, this is the way that God handles this. And you know, that's a good lesson for us today, that when people do things that are outside the framework of God's word, and you wonder, well, I wonder if it's because they did something wrong to make God mad, the best way to not have to answer that question is don't do anything wrong that would make God mad to the point he would want to take your life. And that solves the problem real simple. We always want to blame God, but in reality, we're accountable for our own actions. So let's not start by blaming God. Let's start by examining ourselves. Aaron remained silent. When Moses presented this to him and he told him what had happened, the Bible says in the latter part of verse 3 that Aaron remained silent. That would tell me that Aaron knew that he hadn't done anything wrong. It knew that God hadn't done anything wrong. You know, God gets blamed for a lot of stuff that he didn't have anything to do with. It was either because he was responding to the actions of men or Satan disguised in such a manner that people think it is God that did it, when in reality, it was Satan that caused it. God didn't put it into the hearts of these two boys to do what they did. Satan put that in their hearts to do what they did. And as a result of it, it cost them their life, because God is holy and he will not break or nor will he relax who he is in order to accommodate somebody who does something against his will and violates his holiness. And so we find that the root cause of the problem always goes back and traces back to Satan, and we shouldn't be blaming God for what Satan causes. Aaron remained silent. He knew that God was right. He knew that in this case, Moses was right. You know, and he was a grieving father at this point. He had just lost two of his four boys. Regardless of whatever it was, he was a grieving father. And this was not the time for him to pick battles. And he realized that what Moses had spoken was the truth. Even though the truth is hard, it is the truth. Now, God lays down some stringent rules for us, but he does that because he wants what is best for us. And he does that so we don't have any misunderstandings about what he expects. And that is the greater showing of love, that he loves us enough that he tells us what he expects. And then he doesn't capitulate whenever people come along and want to be the exception to the rule. He treats all people fairly. Man had to show through all this that he could not legalistically approach God, but that it would be by God's grace that one day we would be able to escape underneath this legalistic form of worship that man wanted, that God established. Now, in verse 10, there are some requirements or responsibilities that are identified that belong to the priest. There's three of them, and these are still in place today for us preachers. Number one, distinguish between holy and common. Separate what's the world from God. Show people the clear choices. You can do it God's way, you can do Satan's way, but with each there are accountabilities. With God there are blessings. With Satan there's accountability and punishment. They're supposed to distinguish between what is holy and what is common. They're supposed to distinguish between what is clean and what is unclean. We might say today, what is clean living or versus what is unclean living? What are clean choices? What are unclean choices? What are righteous ways? What are unrighteous ways? However you want to think about it, one of the responsibilities is that we are to show what is clean versus what is unclean. In the next chapter we get into, we'll look at what God determined to be unclean. And the third thing is, you must teach the Israelites all the decrees the Lord has given them through Moses. In other words, we're to teach, we're to educate, we're to reveal what is God's will for man's life so that individuals can make clear choices between God's ways and Satan's ways. But these are the three responsibilities, among others, but these were condensed in verse 10, to distinguish between holy and common, to distinguish between clean and unclean, and then to teach in all the laws and all the decrees that Moses will teach you, which we know Moses got them from God. So it'd be like the preacher preaching the word of God, which came down from God, written into his word. Now, the chapter closes by showing us the fact that there are conflicts that occur between people, even believers. There's conflict that occur. We find that Moses re-educates them as far. Now, the other thing that happened was Aaron's uncle had two boys, and Moses replaced Aaron's sons with these two boys. And we find that as Moses talks to them, he talks to them as though they are his own sons or as they are Aaron's sons. So it was like the old was out and the new was in, and they brought two in for two. And so he appoints them to take the place of the two sons of Aaron that were killed. And it shows also that Aaron still had two other sons, because God, or because Moses chastised them because they handled the sacrifices wrong in verse 16 through 18. Now, this is hammer speculation, take it for what it's worth, but I wonder, here are four of Aaron's sons And each one of them seemed to have a problem understanding what God expected when it came to offering up the offerings. I'm not sure how good of a job either Aaron did in teaching them, or how good of a job he did in disciplining them, or how good of a job he did in giving them a set of expectations that would bring them up to what God wanted as far as people that are in service and conducting himself on behalf of God. We find that Aaron also said in verse 19, when he replied to Moses, basically what he's saying, hey, I've done the same thing too. And he was apologetic for it because he realized maybe that he had not been holding it to the highest expectation that God expected him to do. And then we find that the last verse says, when Moses heard this, he was satisfied. So there was conflict between Aaron and Moses throughout all this. Remember, though, Aaron was a grieving dad who had lost two of his boys, and sometimes tensions run high. But nonetheless, it was a checkpoint, if you would, for everybody to realign with what God expected whenever it comes to the offerings that we make unto him and how we handle things that are being handled in his name to present him as holy. The takeaway from this, I guess the lesson that we would take, or the lesson we would take away from today, would be that we want to be in the center of God's will. And these boys that lost their life were not in the center of God's will. It sounds like Aaron was not in the center of God's will. It sounded like the others were not in the center of God's will. And as a result of it, it caused great difficulty and it created great burdens. And it caused conflict. Best thing we do is say, God, okay, I'm going to do better. And please forgive me and move on. Because God is a gracious God, a loving God, and a caring God, and that's what he wants to do. So if there's something that's standing between you and God because you got something unholy in your life, just ask God to forgive you and get back in the straight and narrow. Remember the lesson that it cost these two boys. We wouldn't want it to cost us either. Hope you have a great day.